The topic given to me is controversies to consensus. I sort of plan to cover it in 3-4 basic areas. Blood pressure being such a very, very common issue, and despite of the fact that it is such a common issue, we have so many uncertainties. And I think I would just try to highlight the controversies. I don't know whether we'll be able to get to a consensus from the current data, but I'll just help you to understand some of the controversies in such a common disease which we all treat day to day. So we'll look for something in simple fact of blood pressure measurements, then we'll talk about the targets, and then of course very commonly discussed area of beta blockers in hypertension and timing of antihypertensive therapy. In the Indian scenario, we all know that hypertension has increased tremendously, and it amounts almost to 35% of population. So we have a huge burden of hypertension in India. Rural India is not behind, and the prevalence of hypertension approaches almost to that of urban Indian population. Now, on that backdrop of 30% prevalence, we have a very poor detection, treatment, and control rate of hypertension. In the Western world, they talk about a 50% rule of hypertension. That means 50% are detected, 50% are treated, and 50% of the treated are controlled. But in India, we have this rule of 30%. So out of the hypertensives in the population, we only have 30% detected hypertensives. Of the detected hypertensives, we have only 30% treated. And of treated hypertensives, only 30% are controlled to the targets. So it's a grave problem that we are facing. If we come to actual control of hypertension in the society, it will not be even 7% of all the hypertensives. So we are doing very, very poor on targets. And there are multiple reasons to that. And the reasons start from simple blood pressure measurements. We are confused actually about the blood pressure measurement, starting from Reverend Stephen Hales, who actually tried to measure the blood pressure. Most of you must have seen these pictures of he putting a brass bar in the neck of a horse, attaching it to multiple tubes and trying to measure it with a mercury column or a water column, which was converted into a clinical science by Rivaroki in 1890. And there the word sphygmomanometer was coined. We started measuring blood pressure in human beings using this simple method. And Norman Kaplan, who is one of the leading authorities on hypertension, commented in 1998 that measuring blood pressure is a clinical procedure of greatest importance, but we are all doing it in the worst possible way. It's the sloppiest way that we measure our blood pressures. And therefore, we must be very, very aware about how to measure blood pressure. Various guidelines do give us all the details. Indian guidelines, likewise, the Western guidelines tell us the details how we should be measuring the blood pressures. I will not go into great details of each of these lines here. But the patient should be comfortably seated, you should have a correct size cuff, and then at least for the first time have 3 readings 2 to 3 minutes apart. And if you don't do that, you get these differences in the blood pressure. So by application of wrong methodology, you get these differences of blood pressure. Now, all the understanding and data of today's era, or majority of it, comes from what we call as office blood pressure measurement. All the trials employ the technique of office blood pressure measurement. And therefore, there are newer techniques, and we are confused that which technique is the correct technique, or which one single parameter shall we take into account. We all know that ambulatory blood pressure monitor is something which measures blood pressure round the clock. You can set the frequency on the blood pressure monitor from 10 minutes to 30 minutes, and the monitor will give you a complete record of 24 hours. This will enable you to get the average blood pressure over the day, and it will also give you the type of dipping, because when we sleep, the blood pressure is expected to reduce slightly. People who are non-dippers have been shown to be exposed to higher problems. But the problem comes here. We have different levels of normalcy for office blood pressure, which are given in the standard guidelines. But the levels for ambulatory blood pressure monitoring are different. So there is a confusion. Which one is to be followed? Do you follow ambulatory blood pressure levels? Do you follow the standard office blood pressure level? Or you try and use something else, which is home blood pressure monitoring. Now, home blood pressure monitoring is also being promoted by many bodies because it is simpler alternative to ambulatory blood pressure monitoring. However, you have certain data which has just come in. This is 2016, I think August, where they presented this honest study, which is a study which included almost 20,000 patients and tried to measure the home blood pressure. They came up with the conclusion that early morning home blood pressure is strongly related to the outcomes in terms of strokes and myocardial infarctions. But the editorial on the same article says that we are still away from recommending something very strongly on home blood pressure. So we are confused whether it should be office blood pressure, it should be ambulatory blood pressure, it should be home blood pressure, or something more, which is central aortic pressure. Few years back, we had a lot of talk and discussion about the ASCOT study and the CAFE sub-study of ASCOT, which told us that beta blockers do not reduce central blood pressure and therefore they are bad. Amlodipine reduces central blood pressure and therefore it is good. We must understand that central aortic blood pressure measurement is an indirect technique. There is no direct measurement of central aortic blood pressure. It's an indirect technique which is from the peripheral arterial tresses. What they use is called as a fast Fourier transformation of the arterial waveforms which calculate central aortic pressure. So it's an indirect technique. The devices are expensive and difficult to handle, and therefore it has not found much of usage in the clinical utility. So we come to a basic fact that our blood pressure guidance is our office blood pressure. Now, what is the way? Sprint is another trial which has been discussed so much over the last 1 year, and intensive blood pressure reduction by sprint way. Now, it has come to a huge criticism. The way blood pressures were measured in sprint trial, the person was made to sit in a quiet room for 5 to 7 minutes. All the medicals and paramedical people left the room, and the person was handed over with an automated instrument to measure his own blood pressure. The person came out and gave the data. Is this a correct way of measuring blood pressure, and can it be practiced in clinical medicine? This is under severe criticism, and therefore the results of sprint, can they be applied, is a big issue. This is a critical letter which appeared in New England Journal of Medicine on sprint trial 6 months after the trial was presented, and it showed that you measure the blood pressure by sprint way and you measure office blood pressure of the same person at the same time, you will get a difference of 8 to 10 millimeters of mercury. And therefore what we achieved in sprint is actually 130 plus in the clinical practice. So, measuring blood pressure, we are still at office blood pressure, and therefore we must learn to measure the office blood pressure correctly. Coming to the next point, targets of blood pressure. We have been discussing targets, and the sprint trial has shown us intensive is better, but I showed you one of the fallacies of sprint. Nevertheless, so-called JNC8, which was given a few years back, was again criticized largely because they recommended a target of 150 by 90 for people older than 60 years of age, and this has never been there in any of the recommendations. However, that apart, we have lot of discussion about getting to lower targets or better targets. And the first trial of trying to reach better targets was sort of ACCORD trial, which was published in 2011. Despite of achieving a good blood pressure difference of 14 by 6 millimeters between intensive arm and non-intensive arm in diabetics, it failed to show any difference in the outcomes. Not only that, people who were randomized to intensive arm faced more hypotension, worsening creatinine, declining GFR, and these all things were more common in the intensive. And therefore, the recommendation was that in diabetics, do not try to achieve a very tight control in management of hypertension. This is another trial which is called as SPS3 trial, which is published, which was published in 2013. This was a trial in patients of lacunar strokes. And again, they tried to reduce blood pressure less than 130 versus a usual control of 130 to 150. They could get difference between the groups on treatment, but the outcomes did not differ. However, the patients who were targeted with blood pressure of less than 130 had less of hemorrhagic strokes in the follow-up. And the trial concluded that targeting blood pressure of less than 130 in a person who has suffered lacunar stroke can be a worthwhile option. This was followed by the much talked about SPRINT trial, which showed that getting blood pressure below 120 in non-diabetics. Because these investigators were wise not to involve diabetics on the backdrop of ACCORD trial. So they left out diabetics and they set out to define if blood pressure less than 120 in people who are non-diabetic is better, and they were obviously able to show, but mind you, this came at a cost of more frequent side effects. Hypotensions were more common, syncope was more common, electrolyte abnormalities were more common, and the need of drug was much higher in the intensive group. Now, with this information and the blood pressure measuring technique which was employed in SPRINT, we really need to have rethink about SPRINT trial. There were two meta-analyses which followed immediately the SPRINT trial, and both of them showed that intensive control of less than 130 is better. The second meta-analysis showed that the intensive target of 130 by 76 gave significant reduction in the endpoints of cardiovascular mortality. But a discussion on J-curve phenomena has resurfaced with presentation of SPRINT trial. From TNT trial shows that in patients of cardiovascular disease, if you go below 146 systolic and 81 diastolic, you actually start increasing the events. So reducing blood pressures to very tight targets may not be of great help in treating patients, of especially for the cardiac endpoints. The stroke endpoints do reduce significantly when you reduce. And this is the latest in the line, that you have a data from what is called as ERIC study. This is atherosclerosis in the community study. This is a study of 21 years in a community, and they measured blood pressure and other basic parameters, including troponin T, at different time points. Now, troponin T, even in a healthy individual, measured by ultra-sensitive assay beyond a certain cutoff level, indicates future events. And what they found was, if your diastolic blood pressure is less than 70 in a normal healthy person, he has more chance of worsening troponin and poorer cardiac outcomes. So there is one more evidence now to make us cautious about very stringent targets of blood pressure in patients of cardiovascular disease. Another data, again appeared in August 16. This is from what is called as Clarify Registry. And this data once again confirms that if you reduce blood pressure below 120 systolic and 70 diastolic, you may end up with higher cardiovascular events. So again, we are confused at this time. the systolic blood pressure target of less than 120, less than 130, or do we stay with the currently recommended target of 140? The final word is yet to be out. Third contentious point is, of course, beta blockers. And you see the Indian guidelines still putting beta blockers in the treatment of hypertension. Now, we understood from these two important trials, LIFE and ASCOT, that atenolol is not a good beta blocker in control of uncomplicated pure hypertension. When there are overlapping recommend or overlapping requirements like person of cardiovascular disease, beta blockers have to be there on board. But if person is having uncomplicated hypertension, question is whether some person should receive beta blocker. And all our understanding and data is based on atenolol. And therefore, there is a strong recommendation from some experts like Kim, who tell us to have a relook at beta blockers and consider the new generation beta blockers as therapy for hypertension, especially in the young patients. Now, we have beta blockers divided into generations, and we have a beta blocker nebivolol, which is the third generation beta blocker, just like carvedilol and celiprolol. Now, carvedilol, because the dosages required to control blood pressure are very high and the cost effectivity is not much, it may not be really discussed in the control of blood pressure per se. But nebivolol is definitely an option to treat beta blockers because it has a very, very high beta 1 selectivity. It is a vasodilator as compared to other beta blockers. It also causes endothelial mediated vasodilations as compared to atenolol. If you inject acetylcholine and do the forearm vasodilatation test, you will see that nebivolol gives much better vasodilatation as compared to atenolol. Nebivolol also acts through release of nitric oxide, causing significant vasodilatation, and it also controls blood pressure. So nebivolol controls blood pressure well. It has vasodilatory properties, and it may be one of the considerations as far as beta blockers are concerned in treatment of hypertension. So, as far as beta blockers are concerned, we must understand that not all beta blockers are same, and extrapolating the data of atenolol to other beta blockers may not be great. So we must be cautious there, and we must innovate here. And I actually request Cadila to sort of conduct a medium or long-term trial of nebivolol in Indian hypertensive patients, looking at worsening of glycemic control and control of hypertension, so that we can stand up and say that yes, nebivolol given for 1 year in hypertensive patient provides good results without getting into side effects. But we need more data for that, and I think Cadila can have this as one of the innovations there. Fixed dose combinations, treating hypertension is no more treatment of blood pressure. We are treating the overall cardiovascular risk, and therefore the concept of polypill. So Nick and Wald floated this concept of polypill, which said that if you have a statin, an AC inhibitor, a beta blocker, and aspirin, you would be able to reduce cardiovascular events by 70% just by adding statistically different reductions with individual drugs. And that is how the concept of polypill came. Again, Cadila took it up very significantly, and they introduced the polypill, which is a polycap, which contains hydrochlorothiazide, atenolol, ramipril, simvastatin, and aspirin. And they have done significant work, and this is really a proud thing that a study was published in Lancet, because publishing one single article in Lancet is like doing a PhD. So study publication in Lancet is really a great achievement, and TIPS 1 was published in Lancet. I will not go into the details, but these were the short-term studies, and they showed that a polycap can reduce blood pressure significantly. This was followed by TIPS 2, and the overall result, I'll just show that the overall result and the projected benefits of polypill in form of polycap can reduce cardiovascular morbidity and mortality significantly in the patients of cardiovascular risk. That means people who are intermediate or high risk can be treated, and therefore they have a large international study which is going on, which is called as TIPS 3. We expect the results to come back in 2019. So hopefully we will get into that. HOPE 3 in another form was a trial of polypill. Although the drugs were not combined in one single pill, the drugs were given, candesartan, hydrochlorothiazide, rosuvastatin to patients who were intermediate or high risk. But unfortunately, in non-hypertensive high-risk patients, candesartan, hydrochlorothiazide did not show great benefit. And therefore, HOPE-3 commented that our data is compatible with the hypothesis that treating people with CVD or who have high blood pressure appears to be beneficial, but the benefits need really to be weighed in treating people who have starting blood pressure less than 140. So polypill, again, the polypill which we currently have has atenolol as beta blocker. So what should be the real content and composition of a polypill is an issue. And the magnitude of benefit will come in front of us after TIPS 3. And finally, we have some data coming in that a night dose of antihypertensive medication does better than a morning dose of antihypertensive. So the larger dose of antihypertensive medication needs to be given at bedtime rather than in the morning. And this was one of the trials which showed that you improve the non-dipping character of an antihypertensive or of a hypertensive person by giving a night dose of antihypertensive medication. And there is some data to this effect, but overall, we do not have a very strong recommendation at this time about morning versus evening dose of antihypertensive. Personally, I have a feeling that if we are treating a stage 2 hypertensive patient, that means somebody who has a blood pressure of 100 diastolic or above and 160 systolic or above to begin with, these people generally will need two dosages rather than one single dose. And therefore, the only question remains is when to give the dominant or larger antihypertensive dose. And these two trials will try to address this issue. So to conclude, ladies and gentlemen, numerous gray areas exist in a very, very simple disease like hypertension. Knowledge about controversial areas is important, and I just tried to focus some of them and bring it to your notice with especially the recent data which has appeared after sprint trial. So a role of a clinician here is extremely important, because you have to get the data, use it for your benefit, and then translate it into the benefit of the patient. Thank you so much for your patient listening.
If a patient is well controlled with atenolol, what should be the strategy? Change it or not? A. And B, what about the blood pressure variability? Yes. How do we address it?
I think if somebody is well controlled, because as we have this data about the drugs and control of blood pressure, we also have significant data from population and insurance registers from Italy and US that the first target is control of blood pressure, irrespective of the drug. So that has the largest effect on the outcomes. So if somebody is well controlled on atenolol, I would not really see a great reason to shift from atenolol unless patient has concomitant other diseases which demand shift to AC inhibitors or ARBs. And the blood pressure variability is of course important, because unfortunately office blood pressure is giving you a snapshot into blood pressure by just measuring once in a day. So the fluctuations in the blood pressure over the 24 hours will definitely be very, very important, and that is coming to focus. But unfortunately, the methods to measure and document blood pressure variability are expensive, and we have serious doubts whether they will be used in clinical medicine anytime.
Sir, is it difficult to reset the patient who is on beta blocker on operation table, terrorist, cardiac arrest. A patient on beta blocker, hypertensive patient, develops cardiac arrest on the operation table. Is it difficult to resuscitate? Is there any data?
Why should it be difficult? It should not be difficult because you see, the patient has not arrested because of beta blockers.
No,
so if you reverse the condition which led to cardiac arrest, patient will be reversed. Only thing is you will need larger dosages of atropine to get your heart rate higher.
As an anesthesiologist,
absolutely, I understand your point.
Patient does not respond to atropine.
Yes, because you will need larger dosages of atropine in excess of 1.8 milligram quickly. Because what we do is we give 0.6 milligrams of atropine and hope that it will respond quickly. That may not happen in a patient of beta blocker. But we first have to decide why did the patient arrest. It is not the beta blocker which caused arrest.
No, my question is it difficult to resuscitate the patient?
That's exactly
no doubt we use vagolytic dose of atropine, 1.2 milligram. Even we go for 2.5 milligram.
Yes, we will have to. No, no. But sir, the resuscitation will depend on what caused cardiac arrest. It is not nothing to do with beta blockers. If you have a myocardial infarction leading to cardiac arrest, how your atropine will increase heart rate in a beta block patient? In fact, people on beta blockers have been shown to be safer on non-cardiac surgery, and withdrawal of beta blockers has shown to increase events in non-cardiac surgery.